here are our three levels. Is we've got learning community, which is a social institution of education. It has a specific place, which might be the school. And I mean, when I say the school there, I mean the school as a physical place, as a building, or and the land around it and whatever. It's also a time. So informal learning is just any time, anywhere you like. Whereas the school happens, you know, you turn up at school at 8:45 and you go home at 3:30, perhaps, whatever it is, or you've got a physics lecture at 6 in the evening. So it's a specified time, which is called the space of education, but also it has a number of institutional roles. It has students, it has teachers, it has principals, it has professors, it has vice chancellors, it has all this stuff. So it's a formally structured institution governed by roles and also governed by rules, the rules of the game. You've got to pass to move on and so on. So it's this highly structured learning community which has these spatial dimension, temporal dimension, and also this institutional rule-based dimension as well. So that's the outside frame of reference. Now, what's the curriculum? The curriculum is a planned course of structured learning, which might be grade 7 mathematics, third year university history, or whatever, right? And what we do is, what's appropriate to that framework of learning, we say, okay, you've got to know this before you come in. We've got some prerequisites. We're going to structure the curriculum so it has week 1, week 2, week 3, and you're going to cover this amount of content. So we build a macro plan. The macro plan might be at a whole program level. It might be at a course level. But we build this structured sequence of activities, which is called the curriculum. Hey, there's nothing else like this in life. In life, which is just lived every day, the world of informal learning, there's nothing like a curriculum in the sense of these distinguishing design features which characterize curriculum. It's to be known not by what's being learned, but by its design features, its structure. And then at a micro level, we have something called pedagogy, which is specific activities, the specific things that teachers get learners to do, and the microdynamics of planned learning, which might be an activity, it might be an essay that you hand in, it might be a question in an exam which has an A, B, C, D answer, it might be the nature of classroom discussion. There are a whole lot of artifacts that we use, and each of those artifacts has a set of microdynamics to it. You know, the teacher asks a question, the student gives an answer. The student reads a text, and then they answer some questions at the end. They're given a prompt, they write an answer. So all of these things have a kind of an activity sequence to them where teacher relates to student, which have these very, very delicate microdynamics. These artifacts, these institutions, these social processes of learning community, curriculum, and pedagogy are actually a relatively recent invention. There are some precursors to modern education. So here we have an image of Plato's Academy. And in fact, there are no images of Plato's Academy. This is an imaginary version of Plato's Academy created in a mosaic found on a floor in Pompeii, an incredibly beautiful mosaic, as it turns out. So it's an idealized version of Plato's Academy. But really, institutionally, where was the building? Curriculum, there wasn't one. Pedagogy, yes, there probably was, but the pedagogy was really just, I'll be facetious, sitting under a tree and talking. No, it was a lot more than that. But nevertheless, the Plato's Academy, where we had Socrates who didn't write anything, then we had Aristotle who did a lot of writing, was this place of dialogue and this place of discussion. But also, unlike modern institutionalized education, this was only for men. It was not for slaves. It was only for a certain class of privileged men. There were presumably a whole lot of warriors who were also part of the same class who couldn't be bothered with it, didn't do it. So it was for a very small minority. So in other words, all the dimensions of it make it very, very different from from modern education in many, many ways. But in a way, what's most important for me is the institutional structures were different at those three levels, at the level of a learning community, curriculum and pedagogy. There were some similarities, and we use the word academy today for academics. We use academy to name some schools, but in some ways it's very different. In the East, roughly the same period, we had Confucius, who was a learned man. Confucius becomes somebody who doesn't, you know, speaks a sort of kind of wisdom, is a set of aphorisms, little sayings. That's what Confucius left with us. Wasn't written down during his lifetime, written down later on, passed down as a set of wise sayings. But again, neither the place where Confucius was sitting under the tree there speaking to disciples, nor the content of what he said was anything really much like contemporary learning communities, contemporary curriculum, contemporary pedagogy. In the Chinese tradition, this evolved into the idea of the Mandarin, the idea of the wise scholar. In fact, again, very much unlike modern education, which is universal, compulsory, the Mandarins were people who had this special skill of writing, and they were used as bureaucrats in a very unequal society. So for tax collecting, so the state became very rich and the emperor had wonderful palaces. They were wise people who knew how to read and write, and the Mandarin was very closely connected to a state which was about gross inequality and redistributing stuff from relatively poor peasants through who were illiterate and uneducated through to a ruling elite. So it was very small, the Mandarin class. But it comes with resonances now, by the way, of the idea of a scholar as a wise person. And you can see there are two scholars, a more senior scholar who's instructing a more junior scholar. But again, these relationships, although they bear some kind of resemblance to the idea of formal education, they are formal education in a way. They're very different from the modern structures of education. And finally, another precursor to modern education is the role of the mother in families as a kind of a teacher of children. Fathers, I'm sure, did it too, but predominantly in a pre-modern sexist universe, it would have been mothers, who perhaps in some cases, if they wanted the children to be literate, took an interest with books. So the role of mother as nurturer was also important, but again, not really in the way that characterises modern institutionalised education.